This is Up Close. I'm Stephen I. Weiss. Best-selling novelist Tova Mirvis has a new novel out, Visible City, in which she explores what happens when people choose to do the things that people just don't normally do. And the themes of the book are consonant with an essay Mirvis recently wrote for the New York Times about leaving her marriage and leaving Orthodox Judaism. We discuss both in my interview with her. And when it comes to how a story gets told, perhaps no one is a better master at putting that narrative to specific ends than the president of the Fox News Channel, Roger Ailes. Reporter Gabriel Sherman examines the history of the man and his channel in his new book, The Loudest Voice in the Room. But first, here's my interview with Tova Mirvis. So, what happens when we're all living in urban areas and we choose to finally cross that bridge and speak to people who we weren't supposed to speak to?
That's the cardinal rule here, right? Don't make eye contact, don't look, pretend that you don't see. And I guess as a novelist, I'm always curious about, well, what happens if you do look? Or what happens if you don't listen to that rule that keeps you apart from other people? And so I guess Visible City really started for me with this question of, what do we see of people? What are those little glimpses that all city dwellers catch of the people across the way? And how do we imagine their lives? And how do they imagine ours also?
Where your previous two books were very heavily Jewishly involved and very specifically in the Orthodox area of Judaism, this book only has hints of that.
Mm-hmm. Well, when I started my first novel, I never set out to say, okay, I'm going to write an Orthodox Jewish novel. That was the book that I wanted to write. I think all writing comes out of the parts of ourselves where we ask questions or what we are thinking about. And so I was interested in thinking about, in my first novels, what does it mean to be part of a community? What are the lines between individuality and belonging and community? And then when I started Visible City, I never really said, oh, I'm not writing a new Jewish novel. It never was this explicit decision. And so much of novel writing for me takes me by surprise. I start out knowing so little of what I'm gonna write at all. And so I started with this idea of a woman looking out her window. And for all the years that I wrote it, I thought that at some point this is going to become a very Jewish novel. Clearly, it's going to round some bend and take me by surprise. And that didn't really happen. And so I feel like the content isn't necessarily as Jewish, but I feel like it's still my Jewish eyes, like very steeped in the Jewish world, looking out at a different set of characters or subject matters.
Right, and that question of how to deal with where one is and one's past is actually, you wrote a piece about that in the New York Times about your divorce and your move away from Orthodoxy and what a rabbi had to tell you about viewing your past and about viewing your future.
Right, well, I primarily write fiction. I've been writing nonfiction recently, which is fun in a certain way, but also nerve-wracking. In fiction, there's always the, you know, people want to point to it and say, oh, that must be you. But there's always this game of it is me, it's not me. And in nonfiction, I guess it's you. I mean,
there's nobody else.
There's no one else to blame for it. It's you putting your own self out there. And in writing about my religious changes or grappling and about my divorce, it was really taking my most private, personal knot of pain and sort of tossing it out into the public sphere, which is nerve-wracking, I have to say.
And that actually kind of uncovers a bit of a theme with all of your fiction, that we all have the stories we tell and the stories we live.
I think there's this sort of plan that we sign on to, that if I go here for a year in Israel and I go to one of these colleges and I get married when I'm 22 or 23, it's, you know, happily ever after, you know, from then on. And of course, no life is like that. You know, there's reality always. And I was interested in writing about that, certainly in the outside world. But I think that is a theme, you know, that is really crucial to me as a writer, that sense of that gap. And I think it's so easy to tell ourselves, it's only me, right? Everyone else is fine, happy. It's just me who has some question, whether it's a religious question or an unhappiness. But, you know, I think that those moments when you peel back those layers are when you really can connect to people.
And now, Roger Ailes in Fox News in an interview with Gabriel Sherman. A key argument in your book, and something that presents a trajectory for it, is the idea that Fox News became more and more an embodiment of specifically Roger Ailes' ideas, and that Roger Ailes specifically had a trajectory of his own that became more and more reclusive, more and more right-wing, and more conspiracy-minded. And I'm wondering how you feel that affected Fox News and how that affected the politics it created.
Without a question, Fox News has evolved through the years, just as Roger Ailes has evolved. And my book traces that history. And when Ailes launched Fox News in 1996, it reflected multiple influences. Obviously, he was the driving force behind the network because he launched it for Rupert Murdoch. But there were other people in the inner circle who could get their way. So the network was, while
the
it was,
inner circle of News Corp.
Of News Corp and Fox News. And when, as Ailes amassed more and more power through the years, as he attained more power because Fox News became more profitable, he got more and more of his worldview onto the screen.
You suggest that with Nixon and with George H.W. Bush, that a lot of the lessons that he brought to making politics marketable, or their politics marketable, is what he brought to Fox News to make a different kind of politics marketable.
Of course, and there is a through line, and that's why I wrote this book the way I did. You know, I set out 3 years ago to write a history of Fox News. I was going to approach it as a sort of a conventional history of this media company and how it became a phenomenon. And very early into that reporting, I realized that the way to tell that story, the only real way to tell that story, is through the life and career of Roger Ailes, because Fox News is Roger Ailes. And as you mentioned, the politics that he learned from Nixon, the wedge issues, the use of issues of class, race, and geography, the kind of resentments of the middle class, middle American voters that he channeled to help Nixon win the election, are the same voters he appealed to in 1988 when he was working for George H.W. Bush. It's how he appealed to them by portraying Michael Dukakis as soft on crime, as kind of soft on foreign policy, as sort of fundamentally un-American in a way. And those are the same politics that you see on the screen at Fox News. It's the same politics that he's applied to making a Barack Obama seem essentially un-American.
One of the things that Fox News does is become kind of an incubator for Republican talent. And this is something I first noticed years ago. Was that it seemed like a number of the people who would be presidential candidates in the future were regular talent on Fox News.
Well, you know, I think that is that was one of the things that really marked a shift at Fox. In about 2006 or so, Ailes started hiring these marquee Republican personalities. Karl Rove was somebody who got a job after the Bush, George W. Bush presidency. He hired Sarah Palin, Newt Gingrich, Rick Santorum, Mike Huckabee. He essentially created Fox News. Transformed Fox News into a holding pen for these Republicans. And as you said, he gave them airtime, he gave them money, and essentially he controlled the conservative conversation in America. And so if you want to be anybody in Republican politics at this point, you have to court Roger Ailes.
And there's a competitiveness that you almost wish were in the rest of the news business. Mm-hmm. The idea that if we get it right and you don't, we're going to magnify that fact. We're going to make sure everybody knows about it. We're going to get that out there in a way that CNN and MSNBC never would face off against each other. The Times and the Post and Washington Post would never face off against each other. But he does.
There is no executive in the media business today as interesting and larger than life than Roger Ailes. He is a throwback to an earlier age of media where they had titanic egos. It wasn't just about the business. It was about winning, as you said. And that's what makes this book such a wild journey, because as a character, he is larger than life. And he's so, whether you love Fox or you hate Fox, he is a compelling character.
That's all for this week's abbreviated web episode of Up Close. A reminder, you can see the full episode of Up Close on the Jewish channel on cable, or listen to the full audio of the show as a podcast, available on iTunes and your favorite podcast player. The Jewish channel is available on cable: Time Warner Cable Channel 528, IO Optimum Channel 505, RCN Channel 268, Bright House Channel 330, Verizon Fios Channel 900, Cox Cable Channel 1, Frontier Communications, and on Comcast in the on-demand menu under Premium Channels. For more information, visit tjctv.com.